looks extremely fancy. Finding the right parts and can make it easier. With one touch, you get connected. With one touch.
Spent all day in the museum, but we didn't have a tour plan. First thing up was amplifier testing. John Myers had a setup here where he had a test bench, and he was showing us how he can compare unregulated versus regulated amplifiers, how voltage affects the power output, and also the efficiency shown between older amps and newer amps, and how much more efficient the newer amps are. So this is a really cool demo. I caught a lot of it on video, but it's just way too much to show you guys here. wallpaper wasn't powered up, and you guys can see how impressive all the time that it would be. Anyway, let's continue to warehouse tour. Get to see all kind of cool kicker signs, including this really cool one. That's really neat. It's like it's the original foot kicker. Look at this new Rob Vega, not Rob Vega, pulling up the signs. And here is the original kicker speaker, $249. It was produced back in 1980. 2 6.5s, 10-inch passive, 2 horn, mids and tweets on the top. See Stillwater's vision here. Yep, it's impressive as always. Here's the section where they do insoles. And this Polaris here is actually being built for SEMA, which I know SEMA's already done a fair amount right now, but SEMA's really cool install bay. They just have everything they need to do these top quality installs. Very cool. Some really cool work stools here. 73 kicker. Then we got to move on to the kicker tractor trailer. Let's get a little bit more about that.
This tractor's in the middle of rebuild right now. Not this summer, but last summer slash spring. We do an event that they have in Kansas called the Country Stampede for the title sponsor. And we actually got a either have one for any of them, straight line, and instead of the issue with the rust, we actually thank you. different seating components, but the bottom of the
Nice.
You can plug in your own market for one of these, become a link in the description, and you get the huge black binder discount. And please use my link, you know, so we can track I sent you and I go in the good books and all. Anyway, let's watch it. He's not fucking at all. What is he hiding? Maybe his accent? I couldn't ask him if he had an accent.
Second wasn't finished.
find tons of people in the exact same circuit for some big grocery stores happen, because apparently it brings news. The benefits of email is my attention. But why does this video say, wow, incredible idea that should be in every home? Haven't you heard of non-contact voltage testers? Not only they light up, they beep when they come close to high voltage, and you can adjust their sensitivity. So the idea is not that incredible. You can buy this anywhere. None of those videos explains how it works, so I assume none of them knows how it works, and that's why they all use the exact same transistor. I found a video from 8 years ago that might be the source to all this. Still doesn't explain it.
Well, at least I'm pretty happy that the viral idea wasn't the hoax free energy mumbo jumbo. The mixture channel has tons of electronic projects you can check. So I guess it's up to you to explain how this circuit works. Go ahead and press like on this video to appreciate my dedication. And buckle up to learn something. This coiled wire is not a coil, but one side of a capacitor, which means if I increase its surface area, actually works better.
See, the live voltage is different for air, and there is a very tiny string capacitance between air, which can be the environment or my body, to the circuit. And with the capacitance between the antenna and the live wire, the circuit closes and you can pick up the live voltage. Here's just a loop on my probe, and you can see the voltage rising when I get close to the live wire. But the transferred energy is so small, even my high impedance probe is loading the voltage and making it smaller. So in order to detect this very low energy voltage source, you must draw extremely small current from this detector loop, and again the bigger surface area picks up a higher voltage. Okay, I'll explain the BJT transistor in my Electro-Open 101 series better later. But basically, for such a transistor, the current into the collector pin is beta times the beta, which is also known as HFE, is a constant that can be pretty high, like 100 or 500, which means with a very small base current, we can start a much larger collector to enter current. Now in our detector circuit, first we have a pair of transistors like this, which is called a Darling bump pair. So if you need a specific upward current, you need beta times a smaller current here, and another beta times a smaller current in the base here. So to create the output current, you only need a super small input current, 10,000 or more times smaller in the base. You can buy these Darlington pairs in one package like a transistor. Now we have this final stage. This transistor acts like a switch. We give it some input base current, and it draws beta times more current at the output and turns on the LED. So for example, if you need 10 milliamps from your LED to turn it on, you need at least 100 times the smaller current here, another 100 times the smaller current here, and another 100 times the smaller here. So you would draw less than 10 nanoamps from your antenna, which makes the circuit work. Now if you want to run the circuit on more than 3 volts, you need to place a series resistor in your LED. If only one of these videos explains the circuit. Now get this video to trending, because if this video deserves 3 million views, mine deserves 10 million. And let me check my Raycon earbuds, link in the description for any of their products to get the Black Friday discount. You can go there directly, but use my link. They say this E25 is the best. Calls, although I can't find the microphone. And the sponsor didn't allow me to
anything. In this instance, if you offer to send me some vintage motorhome, one that's about 60 to 70 years old, and what showed up in the mail was this steel car. So anyway, we're going to open up this steel box and see if there's some vintage motorhome in it, and if there is, let's do some testing on it and see how it performs against modern motorhome. Now, check out this case. This thing has four screws and two bolts holding the cover arm. Have two windows on this side. This thing is amazing. I'd say this is the best protected one I've ever seen. I have to admit, I'm a little bit nervous about opening this box. This seems like way too good of a box for a can of oil. I've probably made a couple of oil companies mad for the previous video, so I'm not so sure I should be opening this box.
That's a loss of 6.63 grams. The 50 Quaker State Farm is 404.
fans to determine if cotton or vintage foil offers the best protection against engine wear. While the literacy tester doesn't simulate engine operating conditions perfectly, it'll provide us with some great information. Still very sluggish. The modern world is picking up speed as it's heading down the home stretch with modern Cook. years? Absolutely. This world is still good. However, it's just not going to be good for long in a modern car. The reason for that, it lacks the detergents and dispersants to keep the engine clean. And because it lacks those, the TDM is very low, a 0.4. So this world will become acidic pretty quickly. And acidic oil is definitely going to cause a corrosion problem. And this world would likely slug up an engine fairly quickly. One thing for sure is, they sure don't make motor oil like they used to. And that's probably a good thing. For our cars, probably wouldn't last that long. Have a lot of fun testing this vintage oil. I just want to say thanks again to the person that sent it to me. It was really interesting to see the difference between the old and the new. The old just did not float very well on that whole oil flow test. Also, it did not do very well on the evaporative loss test. Even in the small engine run, we could see a lot of vaporization coming out of the positive crankcase ventilation tube. 100% of the videos on this channel are video ideas that come from viewers. So if you have a video idea, I hope you take time to leave a comment. I read and reply to as many comments as possible. Just want to say thanks so much for watching the video. Please take care, and I look forward to next time. Provided 2 to 3 times more holding power over nails, making them the perfect choice for many small projects. But what about shear strength? Obviously, shear strength has to be considered for many applications, such as house framing. For today, we'll be testing shear strength for nails and screws to see which one is the best. We'll compare shear strength in 2 separate tests. We'll also take a look at metal fatigue for both screws and nails. In the first test, we'll attach 2 boards, both country and 2x4s, using 2 fasteners. I'll use a jig to make sure the nails and screws are driven in at the same angle every time and equally spaced apart. Once the nails and screws are in position, I'll attach 2 core arms to the test piece and then place the test piece in position for testing. Once the testing begins, an upward force will be applied to measure how much force it takes to separate the 2x4s. We'll test each type of fastener for a total of 3 times. We'll begin testing with the 16-penny galvanized spiral-shaped nail first. While it's designed for patios and decks, which is typically a harder type of wood that we'll be testing, it'll be interesting to see if the spiral design helps. It's very hard to determine exactly when a fastener is beginning to loose grip. Since it's highly subjective, I'll provide that information along with the maximum force required to pull the boards apart. In the first test, we would begin at 118 pounds, but it took a total of 405 pounds to separate the boards. The second one moved at only 50, but required a max force of 323 to separate the boards. The third did a little bit better, with movement at 86 and a max force of 394. 16-penny coated nails are typically used for general construction and framing. Let's see how they compare to the spiral shank nails. The first moved at 328 with a max force of 441, which is better than all 3 tests with the spiral shank nail. The second moved at 363 with 447 max force. The third moved at 146 and 384 max force, which is much lower than the first 2 nails. The 16-penny 3.5-inch ring shank design makes it ideal for load-bearing structures such as pole barns. The first nail moved at 404 pounds with a max force of 648, beating both the spiral shank and the coated nails. Very impressive. The second nail did quite as well, moving at 369 with a max force of 594. The third did a little bit better, requiring 386 with a max force of 561. Impressive results for sure. The 16-penny smooth-shank galvanized nail showed a lot of holding power in a previous test, but will the galvanized coating help in this test? The first one moved at 308 pounds with a max force of 400, which isn't nearly as good as the ring-shank nails. The second one didn't do quite as well as the first, moving at 189 with a max force of 377. The third moved at 174 with a max force of 421. Drywall screws might have great holding strength, but can they handle this type of force without shearing? The first moved at 305 with a max force of 986. Wow, I'm surprised the drywall screws held up. construction has just been exposed as one of the drywall screws sheared off. A lot of viewers requested that TRK number 10 multi-purpose screws be included in this test. While these are 3 1/8 inches in length, which is shorter than the other fasteners for testing, viewers requested these since they are building code approved screws for some applications with the rated shear load of over 1,000 pounds force. They look written on paper, but let's see how they can do in this test. The first look at 305 with the match was 791. Very impressive. The second digit quite as well, moving at 335 PS 572 max force. The third did slightly better, 342 with the max force of 660. None of the screws sheared off during the testing. When previously testing deck screws, they demonstrated amazing holding power over all the other fasteners, but can they survive this type of force being applied in this grueling test? The first one at 365, the max force of 907. The second did very well, 387 with the max force of 835. The third didn't move until 450.
Look at how many tulog.
Yeah. first year of cake required 695 pounds to be extracted. The second did even better at 766. The third did nearly as well at 719. Very impressive performance.
Especially how to design the text. Even your other tabs are tied to
keeping this on each one of the screws and nails to evaluate how effective the coatings are at resisting oxidation. I'll be applying several coats of this powerful mix in the next 48 hours. It's only been 30 seconds to deal with the nails and
hard. 당연한 BBS. 이해 가시면
The seventh and final nail did a great job at 422 pounds. So just by adding the galvanized coating, the amount of holding strength was 382 pounds on average, which is 249 pounds more than the uncoated nail and 140 pounds more than the coated sinker. I'm really surprised by these results. Costing 9 cents each, these galvanized spiral shank nails are advertised for paddings and decks, which is typically going to be a much harder type of lumber than we'll be using. However, it's going to be interesting to see if the spiral shank helps with providing more holding power. The first galvanized spiral shank nail didn't do too well, losing grip at only 108 pounds. The second one didn't do much better, only requiring 130 pounds to remove the nail. The third one was up slightly to 149 pounds, but still not very impressive compared to the other nails. The fourth was almost the same as the other, requiring 147 pounds. The fifth was really low at only 91 pounds, and was a low sample taken in the category, so I'm going to have to do this one out. The sixth was back up a little to 119 pounds, which is slightly below the category average. The seventh one was the best yet at 173 pounds. So it just goes to show that the spiral shank nail just doesn't do very well in soft wood. I believe it would do much better in a hard type of wood as it's designed and used for. Costing 6.5 pennies per nail, these uncoated ring shank nails are designed for pole barns and load-bearing structures. Since they're uncoated, they're not designed for pressure-treated lumber board application where rust is an issue. The ring shank design is supposed to offer optimal holding power in soft and medium wood. So let's see if this nail design is going to offer more holding power. The first uncoated ring shank nail required 425 pounds, which is very close to the average for the galvanized nails. The second one required 357 pounds, which is a little lower than the first one, but still very impressive. The third one was even better than the first two, requiring 462 pounds of force. Very impressive. The fourth one was a bit lower, 385 pounds, but that's still pretty remarkable. The fifth one was the best of all the samples, requiring 491 pounds. I find it pretty amazing that one nail has that much holding power. The sixth one was the lowest at only 227 pounds. The seventh and final nail was 341 pounds. What was very interesting is that the galvanized blue shank nails seem to continue to have decent holding strength even after they began to slip. However, the ring shank nails really lost a lot of holding strength after the nail began to move. I really like using these 3.5-inch drywall screws for those small projects around the home that require a lot of holding power. So will these number 10 core spread drywall screws provide more holding power than any of the nails we tested? At 6 pennies per screw, it's actually less expensive than some of the nails we tested. The first drywall screw delivered a very impressive holding strength of 703 pounds, beating all the nails by well over 100 pounds. The second one is even better at 841 pounds, really highlighting the amazing holding power of this type of fastener. The third one required 693 pounds, which is still very impressive. The fourth one did quite a bit better than the third one at 758 pounds. The fifth one was slightly below average in this category at 695 pounds. The sixth one is up slightly to 699 pounds. The seventh and final drywall screw did pretty good at 743 pounds. So the drywall screw actually beat all of the nails. Very similar to the ring shank nail, the drywall had great holding power up until it began to slip and then quickly lost all of its holding power as the wood fibers were ripped loose. Costing 13 cents each, deck screws are designed to provide tremendous holding power and resistance to rust and corrosion. So how much better are these over nails and do they offer more holding strength than drywall screws? Let's find out. Wow, the first deck screw required a very impressive 973 pounds to remove, which is more than any of the drywall screw samples. The second deck screw required 1,290 provide this much strength. The third one requiring 792 pounds was the lowest of the seven samples. The fourth one was way back up to 1,174 pounds. Very impressive. The fifth one was down a little to 1,001 pounds. The sixth one did extremely well, 1,284 pounds. The seventh and final dexter was down a little to 1,059 pounds. So after throwing out the highest and lowest numbers for each fastener, the galvanized spiral shank only required 131 pounds of force, which is the worst of the bunch. The uncoated sinker was slightly better at 133 pounds. The coated nail showed a huge advantage over the uncoated ones. The galvanized smooth shank and uncoated ring shank did even better, both delivering nearly 400 pounds of holding strength. The drywall seemed really impressed with providing nearly twice the holding power as the nails. Finally, the dexterous provided nearly 3 times as much holding strength as the strongest nail and over 400 pounds more strength than the drywall screw. There's many different ways to look at different types of fastener from a value perspective. If you consider the number of pounds of holding force per penny, the drywall screw is the best value at 114 pounds of holding power per penny based upon the price I pay. Even though the deck screws are very expensive, they came in second place. The ring shank nails also did great, costing 1 penny for 59 pounds of holding force. Obviously, this is just one perspective, and there are many other things to consider. Regarding the corrosion test, after 40 hours and 10 applications of the hydrogen peroxide vinegar and salt mix, the most rust formed on the uncoated sinker and the ring shank nail. The coated sinker and drywall screw had a small amount of corrosion, and the deck screw and the two galvanized nails did not have any visible signs of corrosion. And when it's time to tackle that next project around the house, I definitely feel like I'm better informed and having the right type of coating makes a huge difference, not only regarding corrosion control, but also regarding holding power. I was more surprised at how much extra holding power these nails had with just having some galvanizing on them. Also, regarding the screws, it's not very practical to use screws for every project, but whenever you can use a screw, it's amazing just how much holding power it provides. I get all my video ideas from you guys. You guys recommended this one. I really appreciate it. You guys have the best video ideas, so please keep those ideas coming, and I'll keep making videos. Thanks so much for watching, and I look forward to next time. Since the previous video on duct tape, a lot of new products have hit the market. Some of these products claim to be 100 times stronger than other products. Are some of these products really just that good? Well, we're about to find out. And the first test will be applying the tape to this piece of metal, and then applying the upward force to a similar wrench to take in half. The second test will be evaluating the wrap strength of each product. The third test will be comparing the adhesive ability of each tape in a showdown to them. In the final test, we're going to see if we can use the strongest tape as a toe strap to pull this very heavy tractor up a slight grade. These duct tapes were tested in a previous video and then exposed to severe weather. In this video, we're going to do some very quick testing on these products to see which brand is the best. Costing $6.59, we'll be testing the Duct Tape Duck brand to see just how well it performs against other brands that have much more marketing tactics. We're going to apply upward force and some aggressive tape. That brand took 44 pounds of pulling force to snap the tape on the first of 5 samples. The second sample took 48 pounds. The third stayed the same at 48. The fourth was only down 1 pound to 47. The fifth was down again slightly to 44. So very consistent results, all between 44 and 48 pounds. Costing only $5.12, the Duck Max Strength puts a strip cleaner on the side of the packaging which shows this tape is all the way to the right as far as strength. The first was 71 pounds. The second was down slightly to 70. The third dropped to 69. The fourth stayed the same at 69. The fifth was up slightly to 71. Once again, very consistent results between 69 and 71 pounds. So what about the 3M brand? Costing $7.79, 3M claims it makes a pro-strength professional industrial HVAC duct tape. My side of 3M duct tape. provides spread and ground tissue garden breathability. So this product actually doesn't claim to be the strongest or the best. The first was 62. The next was up slightly to 63. The third stayed the same at 63. The fourth was down slightly to 62. The final one was down slightly to 61. Very consistent results again for between 61 and 63 pounds. Slightly to 108. The fourth was back down to 106. The fifth and final was down slightly to 103. So very consistent results.
Very impressive performance by Krillin, beating both Duck as well as 3M, coming in at over 100 pounds and ripping his piece of tape in half. Very few of the products we're testing claim to provide a permanent solution, but this one does. It's supposed to be a permanent Gorilla tape that's designed for all weather. It's supposed to resist drying, cracking, and peeling caused by sunlight, heat, cold, and moisture. Unfortunately, the adhesive let go before the tape grips, and what that to do is reinforce the tape around the edges to keep from slipping. Gorilla Weather did great at 105. The second was down slightly to 101. The third was up slightly to 102. The fourth stayed the same at 102. The fifth was down again to 101.
The Gorilla Weather tape doesn't seem to be quite as strong as the regular Gorilla, but it's very close. It also seems to have a lot more elasticity to it than the regular Gorilla tape. Costing $6.99, T-Rex claims to be a ferociously strong tape. Sure Tape manufactures both the Duck brand tapes as well as T-Rex. T-Rex did very good on the first sample at 101. The second one is up a little to 105. The third was 106. The fourth was 101. The fifth was up again to 106. It looks like Gorilla has a slight edge over T-Rex as far as strength. This is that same feeling sticky. I'm looking forward to testing just how easy this thing is compared to the competition. Costing $14.99, more than twice as much as the regular T-Rex, and this T-Rex grew 4 speed. several things to consider when selecting the right tape for a job. If it's all about the tensile strength, T-Rex Brute Force totally dominated the competition, delivering over 450 pounds of tensile strength. Vitafix came in second place with a very respectable 224 pounds. Gorilla and Gorilla Brother and T-Rex were all a virtual tie at just over 100 pounds and very well matched with a very good adhesive. Duck Max, 3M Pro Strength, and Duck didn't deliver nearly the strength, but those tapes aren't nearly as thick and might be a better choice for some applications where thickness is a factor more than strength. In order to test the wrap strength of each product, 1¼-inch plastic pipes were cut into 4-foot sections.
Amy.
Each pipe beginning 1 foot from the end of the pipe. The pipes were then cut into 2 pieces. The pipes were cleaned with rubbing alcohol prior to the cut being applied. Pipes are wrapped 3 times directly on top of the cup, then wrapped 3 times to the left of the cup, 3 times to the right of the cup, and finally 3 times directly over the center of the cup again for a total of 12 wraps. The tapes were then tested 12 hours after they were repaired with tape. Costing $11.46, we're also going to be testing a fiber fix repair wrap. Now, we can't use this in all tests just because it's not designed for the type of testing we'll be doing, but we are going to be testing it on a wrap pipe to see how much strength it provides compared to these other tapes. Fiber fix was placed in the water for around 12 seconds, then wrapped tightly around the pipe and allowed to fully cure before testing it the next day. In the next test, we'll be testing the wrap strength of each one of the tapes. So what I'll do is insert the pipe into the pipe holder and use 25 pounds on top of the pipe, beginning with where the crack is located, all the way out to the very end of the pipe until each one of the pipes fails. Okay, so we went 8 inches out on the pipe with Duck. Okay, Duck Max also failed at 8 inches. Okay, 3M failed at 9 inches. To prevent the steel chain from sliding down the pipe, I added a little bit of tape to the chain to give it will compete against the winner of the next round. Death Max is on the left, then Gorilla Weather, then Gorilla, and finally T-Rex Brute Force is on the right. The tape lineup is now set for the second round of competition. Both Death Pro and T-Rex Brute Force are slipping at nearly the same time. The Gorilla tapes are taking advantage of their double flip and double stick capability. Gorilla's the third to lose traction, and Gorilla Weather isn't budging. The race is essentially over for both Death Max and T-Rex Brute Force, and it all comes down to which of the two Gorilla tapes will face off against T-Rex. Gorilla's now really beginning to slip as Gorilla Weather demonstrates a very impressive adhesive ability, and it's Gorilla Weather for the win. Gorilla Weather's on the left and T-Rex is on the right. In the tensile strength test, T-Rex demonstrated slightly more strength than Gorilla Weather. In the tight wrap test, Gorilla Weather demonstrated slightly more stretch. With an extra 5 pounds for a total of 15 pounds in this next showdown, which brand is going to stick the best? Gorilla Weather is the first to begin slipping, but it's not giving up. Wow, T-Rex is suddenly on the move. Oh no, Gorilla Weather suddenly lost grip and is T-Rex for the win. Some brand new plexiglass. I went in and peeled the plastic coating that's on the plexiglass box, so the surface is really clean, and then I applied it to the duct tapes. Now, once these products are exposed to the sun, it's going to have a huge impact on the adhesive material as well as the duct tape itself. So we'll see how each of these products does. Just a quick look at the tank that's been exposed to the weather for around a year. This is Harbor Freight. This is Pollock & Gaffer, T-Rex, Gorilla, Flex, Hurricane. This is just Duck. This isn't the Duck Max. That's your opportunity, sir. As you can see, Harbor Freight did not do too well. There's not much left to just take. A little bit of the fabric underneath, but it's just left a big mess. We're going to peel off this polygon tank and see what's underneath. As you can see, this is pulling up very easily. Not a whole lot of strength left. The weather pulled this stuff up pretty bad. How about T-Rex? Okay, there's a lot of force required to pull this tape up. It's not coming up very easily. Okay, this tape is still glued very well to Plexi. All right, let's see Gorilla. Gorilla just did not hold as well after all the weather exposure. The adhesive underneath has become extremely brittle and is crumbling. All right, Flex is just not going to come up. Flex is definitely sealed up against this plexiglass and is not going to move. Okay, how about the Hurricane tape? Actually, Hurricane tape is doing pretty good. It's actually held up fairly well. It's not as sticky as T-Rex, but it's still a decent tape. We had a hard time getting this tape to stick when we first applied it, but over time, the adhesive has really begun to bond with the plexiglass. Obviously, duct tape didn't do too well, not a whole lot left of this, but Nashaw 357. Yeah. All right, that's coming up without much force at all, so this stuff will not hold up as well as Grub, definitely not as well as T-Rex. About the same as Pollock and Gaffer's tape. Okay, we'll be using T-Rex brute force to see if they can tow this tractor. We'll be right back.
Tagal na yan.
Oh.
my good work unsold. This is the original Hulk with multi seal. Doesn't look like there's any sort of leaking.
Yourself out or help others in the time of need. All the products generally contain just enough content to repair one bullseye.
Señor,
¿qué me ha caído?
¿Cómo te va a contar?